Thank you. So, I'm Sebastian. I'm from University of Duisburg Essen in Germany. And so let me directly continue with where we just left. So a new travel technique for large distances in virtual reality. And when I say virtual reality, I'll already mean head-mounted displays. So please apologize. Okay, so let's imagine putting on your headset and exploring such large and open landscapes freely on your own in virtual reality. Sounds promising. But how do you get from one interesting spot to another? Using positional tracking that comes with most headsets is clearly not enough, since it's limited to your physical play space alone. So what we need is a virtual travel technique. And the most common one is the teleport, which is quite easy, intuitive, and rather precise. But as you see here, the longer the travel gets, it gets quite boring and repetitive. So let's try to find a different approach for such large distances. In this example, we stand on a path that leads to a farmhouse. And instead of directly teleporting there, what we could do now is switching our point of view. So after a short transition, we're now in a scaled third-person perspective. So we can see our avatar that stands on the ground where we left, and we can see the path, and we can see the house. And what we could do now is set a waypoint for our character. So as you see, the avatar directly starts approaching this target at a natural pace, just like we would have walked ourselves. And when he's there, we can then switch back. We could now use the technique to travel even further or stay in the first person to interact with the world on a natural level. So this is our main idea, switching between different perspectives on demand to simplify navigation over long distances and to achieve a fluent experience without any visible cuts or jumps in between. So let's take a look at the details. Most VR games only use a first-person perspective. It provides agency, presence, and it also makes it easy to interact with the world on a very natural level. In contrast, only few developers rely on third-person views. However, this perspective provides an appealing advantage for navigation. So it allows to decouple players and avatar. This makes it possible to move the character freely in the world. The players can observe this locomotion from the outside without getting cybersick. So we combine those two modes together to simplify navigation. But this alone is not enough. So how could we enhance the player's overview so that they can always orient themselves well in the world and know where to go next? Here I want to point to two interesting recent Sikai papers, one by my colleague Andre, one by Parastu Aptai. And both, on a broad scale, did pretty similar things. So they scaled the players to giant size so that they could walk longer distances on foot. This also brought up an interesting advantage of player scaling. So elevating the point of view enhances spatial orientation. So that said, it seemed natural for us to integrate this into our approach. But let me mention here, it is not enough to just elevate the player's height alone, because this would produce a cognitive mismatch and against cybersickness. What we should always do instead is increase the height and eye distance proportionally to avoid such issues. Now, how do we get from the first to the third person? Since we want to eliminate all visible cuts, we went for a gradual transition. But again, as we heard, applying emotion to the player can easily cause cybersickness. So one has to always keep the transition as short as possible. Also, purely scaling the player vertically alone is not enough. Let's take a look at this situation. Here the players are already in third person, but they have to tilt their head nearly 90 degrees down to see their avatar standing at their feet. over a longer time, this posture is very uncomfortable. So what we could do instead is moving them slightly backward. Now they could see the avatar much easier. Now the last thing we did to the transition was replacing the linear one with a smooth curve instead. So it started by moving the player backward first before beginning the actual scaling. The resulting difference is very subtle here, but again makes the whole experience even more fluent and natural. So let's take a look at the final result. So now we can assemble all three main components together. Adding the third-person perspective to decouple player and avatar, using scaling to enhance overview, and transitioning smoothly between both states to achieve a fluent experience. Now it's also interesting to see what players think of this idea. So we did an in-between study to compare it with a standard teleport. And therefore, we placed the participants in a very large open world and had them follow a 2-kilometer-long path where they had to pick up items at designated spots. Afterwards, they described their experiences in various questionnaires. So let's take a look at the results. The first good news is no one had any issues with cyber sickness in none of the groups. Also, we could observe a significantly improved spatial orientation. That itself is not surprising since it confirms the results from previous papers. But we could also, players also mentioned they needed much shorter times to reorient themselves after each relocation. So maybe here the animated transition between both modes helps them to understand this movement. Also, participants that used our approach played on average 16 minutes, which is 66% longer than those using teleports. And this is mostly due to the avatar walking at a natural pace instead of teleporting. Now, this wasn't perceived negative by the players. If we take a look at the rather high results from the presence and enjoyment questionnaires, we see almost equal values among both groups. So despite a much longer playtime, both groups had pretty similar experiences. All in all, players liked using multiple perspectives for long travels. Here they could use very far and few waypoints to travel with minimal effort. However, if you only observe shorter distances, the overhead of switching perspectives first before beginning the actual travel provided an overhead that wasn't perceived that good. So here, most participants would have preferred an additional fallback technique to use for short distances, like the teleport. Now, I've talked already a lot about traveling and navigation. But using multiple perspectives could be useful for more than this purpose alone. So let's take a look at some other use cases. So what abilities do players currently have in third person? Currently, that's mainly only setting waypoints and exploring the world. But why should we stop here? Instead, we could see those two views as two distinct gameplay modes with completely different abilities. For example, we could give the players superpowers in third person, like living heavy obstacles that block the path. Also, which perspective is the dominant one? Are we playing in first person and switch to giant mode from time to time, or is it the other way around? Think of a strategy game where we explore a very large world. If there's an encounter, we could then switch to a first person perspective temporarily and afterwards back. And a final idea, maybe we could use those multiple perspectives to control more than a character in VR at a time. So in third person, it's easy to command a whole squad, for example. Only when we then switch to first person, we would have to choose one NPC. These are only three possible use cases for using multiple perspectives in virtual reality. And I think that there are probably many more. And maybe you have already some own ideas where to use such a technique. So with this, I'm finished, and I'd be happy to discuss this with you further and now answer any questions you might have. Thanks for listening.
Hi, Dimitri from Bremen. I was wondering if this transition between perspectives has an effect on the connection, let's say, between the player and the avatar.
Yeah, we thought so too, but it turned really out. So we did also did semi-structured interviews and stuff, and players told us that in third person they perceived the avatar more like a tiny character you have to guard on your way. So it's not like you're in third person and you're feeling still connected that this is your avatar. It's more like an NPC you are controlling. So it's completely decoupled. This is also maybe quite useful for you controlling then multiple characters at once, because if you don't have such a strong connection to one NPC, you just embody them when switching to first person.
Yeah. Ah, hi. Here, Sebastian.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Hi.
Guillermo from the University of Hannover in Germany. Thank you for your presentation. It's nice that you didn't get any simulator sickness in your participants, but I was wondering if maybe they reported some kind of fear for heights or something like that, because just looking at the whole landscape from above, I think that would be maybe scary.
Honestly, we didn't assess this, but have you ever been to Legoland? You don't have fear of heights in Legoland, so this is really the impression when you scale the play as a whole, also scaling the eye distance. It's really a miniature world, so that's just a tiny character that you control there, and you don't have any feeling of really being like 200 meter tall. So I presume there was no fear of heights. At least players didn't mention anything like that.
Hi, really nice presentation. Elena Márquez Segura, Uppsala University. I was wondering about, like, I saw that you had like all these design considerations when you were designing this transition, right? Like, yeah. That you go back and then up so that it goes smooth and, you know, you don't get any kind of cyber sickness or like a strong negative reaction. And I was wondering first about the other transition. Once your character gets there, like, have you also considered different trajectories to get to that person? That's one of the questions. And then the other one, when you showed the video of the character walking, for some reason, I expected in this kind of god mode to be also following a bit that avatar instead of being, you know, behind. Because also, if you are in that perspective, you wouldn't have to travel that much, right? Like, it would, like, distances would be short. So I was wondering if you thought about that, if you tested that.
Yeah, very interesting question. Thank you. So the first thing with the transition, so we did not differ between different distances, but we did a pre-study to fine-tune the transition, and the transition is very short, so it's only half a second. But we tested different approaches, different trajectories, and the curve felt a bit smoother than the linear one. But there's no real difference between the different distances here. It's just maybe that we're approaching the character's head from the behind, so it's more like embodying him. And considering your second question, this is exactly what produced cyber sickness. So staying with the character and just falling on behind would produce a lengthy animated motion, which would produce cyber sickness. So by decoupling them, yeah, even on the big scale, so by decoupling them, it's completely unproblematic. And just for reference, in our pre-studies, we had an additional technique to catch up on the avatar. Basically, it's just a forward movement to catch up the distance, basically like switching back and forth, only in a linear transition. And if some players overused this, so they used it constantly, and they really got cyber sick. So for our main study, we reduced this, and we cut this feature off, because we didn't want anyone to get cyber sick. We wanted to test this technique alone. But yeah, I think this is demonstrating the answer. it's probably not the best way here.
Thank you. I think that's all the time we have for questions.
Yeah, please catch me up afterwards. Okay.